Lord came to me, saying, Before I formed you in the womb, I knew you. And before you were born, I consecrated you. I appointed you a prophet to the nations. Then I said, Ah, Lord God, truly I do not know how to speak, for I am only a boy. But the Lord said to me, Do not say, I am only a boy, for you shall go to all to whom I send you, and you shall speak whatever I command you. Do not be afraid of them, for I am with you to deliver you, says the Lord. Then the Lord put out his hand and touched my mouth, and the Lord said to me, Now I have put my words in your mouth. See, today I appoint you over nations and over kingdoms, to pluck up and to pull down, to destroy and to overthrow, to build and to plant. The word of the Lord came to me, saying, Jeremiah, what do you see? And I said, I see a branch of an almond tree. Then the Lord said to me, You have seen well, for I am watching over my word to perform it. The word of the Lord came to me a second time, saying, What do you see? And I said, I see a boiling pot tilted away from the north. Then the Lord said to me, Out of the north disaster shall break out on all of the inhabitants of the land. For now I am calling all the tribes of the kingdoms of the north, says the Lord. And then they shall come, and all of them shall set their thrones at the entrance of the gates of Jerusalem, against all its surrounding walls and against all the cities of Judah. And I will utter my judgments against them for all of their wickedness in forsaking me. They have made offerings to other gods and worship the works of their own hands. But you, gird up your loins, stand up and tell them everything that I command you. Do not break down before them, or I will break you before them. And I, for my part, have made you today a fortified city, an iron pillar, and a bronze wall against the whole land, against the kings of Judah, its officials, its priests, and the people of the land. They will fight against you, but they shall not prevail against you, for I am with you, says the Lord, to deliver you.
Thank you. scripture Isaiah 58, verses 6 through 12. Is not this the fast that I choose? To loose the bonds of injustice, to undo the straps of the yoke, to let the oppressed go free, and to break every yoke? Is it not to share my bread with the hungry and bring the homeless poor into your house? When you see the naked, to cover them, and not to hide yourself from your own kin. Then your light shall break forth like the dawn, and your healing spirit spring up quickly. Your vindicator shall go before you. The glory of the Lord shall be your rear guard. Then you shall call, and the Lord will answer. You shall cry for help, and he will say, "Here I am." If you remove the yoke from among you, the pointing of the finger, the speaking of evil, if you offer your food to the hungry and satisfy the needs of the afflicted, then your light shall rise in the darkness, and your gloom be like the noonday. The Lord will guide you continually and satisfy your needs in parched places and make your bones strong. And you shall be like a watered garden, like a spring of water whose waters never fail. Your ancient ruins shall be rebuilt. You shall rise up the foundations of many generations. You shall be called the repairer of the breach, the restorer of streets to live in.
Reading Matthew 25, 31 through 46. And when the Son of Man comes to his glory, and all the angels with him, he will sit on the throne of his glory, and all nations will be gathered before him. And he will separate people one from another, as the shepherds separate those sheep from the goats. And he will put the sheep at his right hand, and the goats at his left. Then the king will say to those on his right hand, "Come, you who are blessed by my Father, inherit the kingdom prepared for you at the foundation of the world. For I was hungry, and you gave me food, and I was thirsty, and you gave me drink. And I was a stranger, and you welcomed me, and was naked, and you gave me clothing. I was sick, and you took care of me. I was in prison, and you visited me." And then the righteous will answer him, "Lord, when is it that we saw you hungry and gave you food, or thirsty and gave you something to drink? And when was that we were naked and we gave you clothing? And when it was that we saw you sick or in prison and visited you?" And the king will answer them, "Truly I tell you, just as you did it one of the least of these brothers and sisters of mine, you gave to me." And then he will say to those at his feet, left hand, "You who are cursed, depart from me into the eternal fire prepared by the devil and his angels. For I was hungry, and you gave me no food, and I was thirsty, and you gave me nothing to drink. And I was a stranger, and you did not welcome me, and naked, you did not give me clothing, sick and in prison, and you did not visit me." Then they also will answer, "Lord, when was it that we saw you hungry, or thirsty, or a stranger, or naked, or sick, or in prison, and did not take care of you?" And he will answer them, "Truly I tell you, just as you did not do it to one of the least of these, you did not do it for me." And those will go away into eternal punishment, but the righteous will have eternal life.
Thank you. requested that you limit your comments to 2 minutes. So I ask you to honor that respect and the request of the family to limit your remarks to 2 minutes. And please follow in the order as indicated in the program.
On behalf of Carl's family, thank you all for coming to honor and celebrate his life today. We are truly humbled to see so many of you here with us today. I'm going to read LaRue Palmer, a member of Carl's church, just gave me a short little thing that she asked me to read, so I'm going to read that just briefly. It says, "Happy birthday, Carl. Rejoice. Go forth with singing into a new day, for we have been shown over once again that God dwells among us. Rejoice. We have not lost Carl. He is not lost, for we know where he is, because we know who he was, and we know whom he knew. Rejoice." So most of you know Carl as an adult. At least in stature and age as an adult. Let me just clarify that. So I would like to share some memories and stories of Carl's childhood and growing up so you can see and enjoy the entire journey of his life. Carl Zerweck III, oldest of three children, born in Kansas City, and moved to St. Louis when he was 13. He was named after his father, Carl Zerweck Jr., and anyone that knew Carl, they knew, please don't call me Junior, I am the third. Growing up, our family loved to camp. We had several trailers, and we camped all over the country. My sister Joy and I, we were the lucky ones because our parents always had Carl stay outside the trailer in a tent all by himself. I'm thinking this is how he came to love the outdoors so much. It started at a young age. One of my favorite vacation memories is the year we went to Yellowstone National Park. Carl would get up before sunrise. Again, we were camping, and again, Carl was in his own tent. He would get up before sunrise and he would go trout fishing. Most mornings during that trip, we all woke up to the smell of fresh trout cooking on the fire. Anytime I have trout, I always think of that memory. He loved to fish. My dad and Carl were both Boy Scouts. Carl achieved Eagle Scout in 1970 and went on to get his Order of the Arrow and award for responsible outdoor adventure and environmental stewardship. Most of you know he was very proud of both of those achievements, and he talked often about it. In fact, he kept his Order of the Arrow Indian headdress, which was a full headdress all the way down to the floor, until about 10 years ago. Until when our father passed away, and we were like, I don't think you need to keep this anymore, Carl. It was all part of his journey, preparing him for God's call in the future. Carl's junior year in high school, I'm sorry, I'm going to be longer than 2 minutes. I tried to keep it short, but it just didn't go there. Carl's junior year in high school, he announced to our family and church that God had called him into ministry. And so he began his journey of serving the Lord. Most of you know that he attended Texas Christian University and became a lifelong horned frog. No one better say anything bad about the horned frogs, or they would hear about it. gladly accepted any clothing, sticker, notebook, pen, whatever, as long as it said TCU. Of course, you saw his wishes were to be buried not in a suit, but in something TCU. Many of you are probably wondering, how did a guy who grew up knowing he was called to ministry, how did he come to learn to draw, build, repair anything, and use any tool he needed? Well, he learned it mostly from our father. Many of you have heard that we have a family house in Tabernash, Winter Park, Colorado. Carl, along with many others, including a few in the audience here, including my sister and I, and my mother, we learned how to install insulation, put up sheetrock, put up paneling, panel the outside of the house, lay carpeting, vinyl flooring, and anything else that my dad asked us to do. Little did Carl know that the skills that he was learning would become God's work across the country, helping build homes, rebuild churches, and eventually starting Rippling Cove to rebuild neighborhoods. Carl loved the mountains of Colorado. We spent many family vacations hiking and skiing. Whenever Carl had a chance, he would head to the mountains to bask in God's beautiful country. He would backpack in Rocky Mountain National Park. One time, he even got lost. We all really wondered if he was coming back. But he showed up the next day, as if nothing had happened. And of course, this was before cell phones, so we really were worried. Carl always said that Colorado was his place to reflect and get recharged to continue his ministry. Some may know this and others don't. Carl drove an Allied van line after graduating from TCU to earn money to pay for seminary. Again, Carl met and helped many people in his time driving a truck. I know that his truck driving experiences provided quite a few stories for many sermons. I'm sure you all have heard some stories about his days driving the truck. I have my own stories. So Carl's journey kept him in Texas for quite a few years at a couple churches, and then he felt a nudge that he didn't want to be tied to a church pastor work, but wanted to do projects and outreach to others, and turned his ministry to disaster recovery across the country. As many of you know, it was through the disaster recovery work that Carl came up with the idea of creating a nonprofit to help those in need for whatever they needed. Rippling Hope was born as Carl's response to serving others who needed help. Many will say this today, you'll hear this today, Carl never met a stranger. Carl had compassion for all people, animals, and our environment. Carl loved his family, parents, sisters, wives, stepchildren, aunts, uncles, nieces, nephews, cousins, etc. Each and every one was very important to him. Our family is sad that he left this earth far too early. He had many more lives to touch, memories to make, servant work to do, but we know he is celebrating seeing our mother and father once again and rejoicing in knowing that he truly gave his all, did his best, and did make a difference to many people who otherwise would have been left behind. Carl was a servant of God in every sense of the word. He would have gladly given everything he had to others just to make their lives easier or better. We should all aspire to be a servant to others, like Carl. Thank you.
Well,
sorry, Dan, I stole all your time.
She not only took my time, but she took my speech.
And
and Carl was my friend. We met some 50 years ago and remained in touch throughout our adult lives. I say adult lives, although the things we did a lot of the times might not have been considered adult life. You've seen Carl at his best, that is his work with Rippling Hope, being on the front lines of service to others, bringing about change by caring. I've got a couple of stories that you might not know if you weren't listening to Jill. That these will be new to you. Carl was a professional over-the-road truck driver for a time between college and grad school. He drove for the Prosser's Moving Company. We called him a bedbug hauler. He drove a truck all over the country delivering furniture. But grad school was beginning for him soon, and so he calls me up and he says, "Hey, Dan, can you drive me to Dallas?" Grad school was beginning soon for him, and he said, "I got a class on Tuesday." This was on Monday when he called. So after working all day, we packed up his pickup truck and we headed to Dallas, some 14 hours until the class starts. After driving a while, the adrenaline of adventure wore off, and I began to realize what I had bought into. Carl wanted me to drive all night so he could sleep and be ready for class. This was a good idea in principle, but what we forgot to take into consideration is that I'm not a night person. And so we drove down to Dallas, and I think I slept as much as he did. Somehow we made it safely to Dallas. He was on time. Carl could pack more activity into a schedule than anybody that I have met. I mean, he just always didn't have a lot of downtime. Carl was an Eagle Scout. And he had every merit badge imaginable. He had camping, hiking, cooking, being the bossy boss on the float trip. Okay, the last one may not be a real merit badge, but if it were, Carl would have it. So he calls me up. He says, "Hey, Dan, can you and Karen be our chaperones for our float trip?" This was for college singles. And Karen and I got married young, so we were their sponsors. We were the only married couple in the group, which made us responsible. Now, float trips in Missouri are canoe floats on one of the many rivers. We made a lot of floats together, a lot of trips, a lot of camping with Carl. One particular float trip, we were all floating together. There was three of us, his buddy Scott and myself and Carl. We tied our canoes together, and we were just really having a great time. Our best girls were in the front of the canoe, and we were in the back because we were control freaks, and that's how you make the canoe work. And Carl thought, "Well, this would be great fun if we would jump out of the back of the canoe and push the girls down the stream, and they'd be helpless, and that would be so funny." And so three of us jump off the back of the canoe, and the girls took off, and they just waved to us. So the three smart guys are trudging down the river, falling, swimming, walking, trying to catch up with them. It took us about an hour. And that was really funny. But Carl liked to organize. He liked to organize those trips. Carl was a minister for the general church. He traveled the country helping congregations plan and build new sanctuaries. And because I had extensive experience in project management and building codes, that sort of thing, Carl asked me to serve on the advisory board. This was a great honor for me. And so he calls me up. He says, "Hey, Dan, can you come to Palm Bay, Florida, Toronto, Canada, Tacoma, Washington, and even East St. Louis?" And I was always impressed with the faith and the can-do spirit of the congregations that Carl worked with. And of course, I was always impressed with his spirit as well. Carl lived to serve others. Carl called me because God had called him. That even with feet of clay, Carl had a great run. I think of the thousands and thousands of miles traveled and the thousands of people whose lives he touched. It is truly remarkable. Carl was clearly our champion, and I will miss him. Thank you.
Carl Zerweck, to the clergy, and to all that loved him. My name is David E. Nathan. I am honored to be here to speak about my friend Carl. I was a newly elected state representative when Carl and I met in 2008. That's when we created the home repair program for Rippling Hope, with Rippling Hope. We came up with a plan to help build and support block clubs and community organizations in my district. What I admired most about Carl was his commitment to service to others. It was his commitment that allowed them to build strong credibility in our Detroit neighborhoods. And if you're from Detroit, you understand what I'm saying. Somebody that's not from Detroit, it is a great feat to be able to build credibility within our communities. I had never seen anything like it. Here was a man that traveled back and forth across the country with his wife, Robin, in a pickup truck and a pool behind for the sole purpose of doing ministry work. Together, Carl and I were able to start the home repair program at no cost to residents that eventually led to stronger block clubs and greater sense of community. What was also extraordinary about Carl, his impact grew, so did his generosity. Whatever Carl received, he shared. For example, he received a discount on paint from Home Depot. He shared that discount with everybody. On a larger scale, a building was donated to Rippling Hope, which in turn he made a community center. The heart of this man was so big. When he came upon an injured dog in the middle of a street in Detroit, he picked it up and took it to the vet. One day when we were having dinner in his pool behind in the parking lot of Northwest Community Church, I saw this dog limping around with a cast on his leg. I asked Carl, whose dog is that? Carl replied by telling me the story about how he ran across a dog that was badly hurt in the middle of the street. He got out of his truck and he picked his dog up and he decided he was going to take this dog to the vet so this dog can be made whole again. Carl, I looked at Carl then and I said, Carl, do you know that's a pit bull? We know the history about pit bulls, right? I don't know if it's true or not, but we know the history. Carl looked at me and he said, the dog needed some assistance. He was badly wounded, and now he's my friend. I can go on and on about my friend Carl's commitment and generosity. Over the years, I watched him build showers and space for other missionaries. I saw him paint porches, fences, and do other things for people he did not know. Not once did I ever hear Carl ask for anything in return. There's a scripture, for even the Son of Man came not to be served, but help others. That was Carl. So I would like to say to you all today that the work of Carl in Rippling Hope will continue through all of us and our commitment to each other and improving our communities. So let's not let this end today. God bless you.
Jeffries, and I am the president of the Ripon Hope Board. I first met Carl in around 2012 when I was working as a community organizer in the city. He invited me over for dinner with he and his wife Robin and gave me an address. I lived in the street, so I drove over and circled the block a couple times, and I called Carl and said, "Carl, the address you gave me is for Northwestern Christian Church. Do you live in the church?" He said, "No. Do you see a broken down RV on the sidewalk with a flat tire?" I said, "Yes, I do." He said, "That's my home. Come on." He and Robin fed me dinner that night. I met RH, their dog, their adopted dog, and we talked about his hopes and dreams for the city. I would be remiss, and I think Carl would want me to thank Reverend Eugene and the members of Northwestern Christian for that first mustard seed planted that became the organization of Ripon Hope as it was nourished by men in the city of Detroit. Fast forward to this past summer, I was working with Ripon Hope. He had a big day with lots of volunteers, and so we were working in the neighborhood. And at the end of that day, after cleanup, as we often did, we had a little side meeting in the Ripon Hope parking lot. Many of you have probably had executive meetings in the parking lots of where you serve. So we were doing some long-range planning and talking, and out of the corner of his eyes, he saw a man who was struggling across Joy Road with a walker. He paused during the meeting and said, "I'll be right back." He crossed Joy Road, stopped traffic, I freaked out, and spent some time with this man, and called over another man who was walking on the sidewalk, and all of a sudden my phone rang, and it was Carl. I said, "Hi, Carl. You know, I can see you." He said, "This man has had a stroke, and he's struggling, and I need to get him to the ATM. I need to get him some dinner, and I need to get him home. So I'll call you later." That was Carl. That was his ministry. It was what he did for other people. Compassion was his lifeblood. His heart pumped it and it ran through his veins, and it touched many, not just in the city of Detroit, but in El Paso and other places that he served. I think God would say, "Well done, good and faithful servant," as we can do that today for our friend Carl. I want to sing greatly. Thank you.
I'm Deanna Arthur. I am the director of the Ferndale Cat Shelter. Carl has spent a lot of his time there for the last 4 months. He has been helping us build our new shelter in Ferndale. I'm gonna read something I wrote, so I'm sorry if it sounds stiff, but I actually am nervous with public speaking. When I started volunteering for Ferndale Cat Shelter about 8 years ago, I wanted to help animals. I needed to do something meaningful with my life, and cats were it for me. What I came to realize early on was that animal rescue often crossed paths with human health, poverty, racism, homelessness, education, a general lack of resources. There was no way that I could succeed in helping homeless cats without addressing these other issues in my community, one person and one cat at a time. So in thinking about Carl and Rippling Hope's relationship with Ferndale Cat Shelter, It makes perfect sense that we connected. We were both working to address the needs of our community holistically, not doing one thing without considering all the other needs around us. And because Carl and I understood that all of these needs are connected, our collaboration was very natural. I've never met anyone as dedicated to service as Carl Zerweck. He made the Energizer Bunny seem lazy. He connected so easily with everyone he met, no matter their differences. He always wanted to know about you, about what you needed, and about how he could help. Then he put his words into action. Making a new friend late in life is a rare gift. I've only known Carl for 6 years. But he was a dedicated friend to me and a friend of the Ferndale Cat Shelter community. And we are forever blessed for having him in our lives. I think that's less than 2 minutes.
Good morning, everyone.
Good morning.
Good morning. I'm Cora Duncan-Foster from Grandma Community Association, and I've known Carl for over 11 years. He was my friend. Carl was amazing, just amazing person. I mean, he worked with hundreds and hundreds of people in my neighborhood. They were all free home repair. I mean, it was so much. He even had time to have him and himself and his volunteers to make a handicap ramp. In fact, a free handicap ramp for someone who needed it. For this amazing man. We all know that Carl loved cats. Oh my God, he had cats all over his house. he gave a presentation at the library in my community about how to take care of your cat during the winter months. He loved our community children. He organized fundraisers to acquire funds to assist with the ministry goals of helping those in need. He wrote many grants. Carl left all over the United States to ask for donations and also for volunteers to come to help us in Detroit. Oh my goodness. Can you imagine Carl worked with 70 block club associations in Detroit? I mean, all of the personalities. Oh my God. Hard work. He worked 14 to 16 days hours a day. Amazing. He even developed programs and made free paint, dog, and cat litter available. His idea was that the residents could get their can buy their items at home and save the money from not having these items bought for their bills. Carl had a connection with the bakery. He even got free bread passed out to the community. He even had planted a garden in Fitzwood's house. And he made people food to give to the neighborhood. Carl was so special, he received many, many awards, a special one from our governor, Gretchen Whitmer. What a wonderful man. Thank you, Carl. We love you.
I first met Carl a year after he moved to Detroit to start his mission work. Carl was a missionary and on a mission of work. Detroit was the perfect place for Carl, as at one time in the United States, Detroit had the largest percentage of single-family homes, shelter. Many of these homes were built in the 1960s, 50s, 40s, some even earlier. Over time, they became in need of repair, a perfect storm of aged homes and aged people. Carl had a mission and went to work. Carl did not judge the people for their living conditions. He just went to work to try to make their conditions better, from windows, plumbing, caulking, painting, building porches, railings, cleaning gutters, mending fences, and yard cleanups, just to name a few. Along with the many volunteers from states, various states, young people, and skilled people to teach and supervise the work. Carl will be missed and remembered. Carl was a missionary on a mission of work. Mission accomplished.
St. Paul's. Carl was a lot of things for me. He was my mentor and my teacher. He was my supporter as I've gone through the ordination process for the United Church of Christ. He was a leader in the church, in our church. Carl wasn't afraid to speak up when he thought that things were taking the long way around. If there was a more direct route, Carol was going to be like, why are we making three lefts when we can make a right? And Jim used to tell him, oh, Carol, you're just being practical again. Everyone has talked about what Carol was. I'm going to tell you a couple things Carol was not. I also served as church secretary here. So Carl and I had a lot of conversations about upcoming events in the liturgical calendar. And sometime, usually the week or so after Epiphany, he would say, are we having Ash Wednesday service this year? We need to get that set up. Yes, Carl, we are, and it'll be in several weeks. Yeah, well, we need to get on it now. Okay, Carl. Procrastination, I don't think Carl used that word. I'm not sure he could spell that word. And he certainly didn't live by it. The other thing that he never taught me about was boundaries. In seminary, they teach you it's very important to have strict boundaries with your congregation, that this is your place and this is their place, and you need to make sure that, you know, we're not working in there. Now, if someone came to Carl and said, Carl, can you blah, blah, blah? Sure, hang on, let me get my calendar book out and see when I can take care of that. And that was the other thing Carl always did. Every year he would say to me, do you have my new calendar book? Yes, Carl, I have your calendar book. Here you go. Or when it came in, I would say, hey, your calendar book is on your desk. Okay, good, because this one's just about done and I need a new one. I think the last thing Carl said to me, not this past Sunday, but the one before, he said, print out the New Year, or the Christmas Eve service and we'll talk about it on Sunday. It's sitting on my desk. So for all you St. Paul people, I'll probably be coming to see you saying, hey, I've got this reading I need to have. So get ready. I'm going to warn you now. Every Sunday I will miss Carl. And probably most Tuesdays and Thursdays and Fridays too. When I heard the news about Carl, all I could think was, yeah, I can see it now. Carl showed up at the pearly gates, and there was St. Peter, and Carl said, "Hi, I'm Carl Zerweck." Come on in. And Carl probably said, "You know, I've got some paint in my building. Can you show me where the rainbow bridge is? Because I've got some cat food I need to destroy. And I'm looking to see our age." So if someone says, "Can you help?" the correct answer is yes. Find a place in your calendar, reach out a hand, give someone an encouraging word, if nothing else, and be present for them. Carl would appreciate it.
Thou art, O great Thou art. endless hymns, my soul, my Savior God, to thee. How great thou art, how great thou art.
Why'd you do that to me? To sing that and then I have to follow that. I once read that prior to his retirement from the faculty where he was teaching, Trinity University in San Antonio, Texas, that Dr. James Samuelson would stand before his students and tell them a story. It was a story about standing up to life's challenges, standing up and making a difference in people's lives. Twice a year, I understand, once at the beginning of the fall semester and once at the beginning of the spring semester, Dr. Samuelson would stand before his students and tell a story in hopes that they would never give up, not on God, not on themselves, and that they would make a difference in their lives. Twice a year, for as long as he was at Trinity, Dr. Samson would tell the story, and by telling it, he would remind himself and his students that life requires our very best. And standing tall to life's challenges so that, again, our lives make a difference in this world. Samson remembers back when at the age of 11, the Nazis came to his town and gathered up all of the Jews. All the people that Samuelson had ever known, mother, father, brothers, sisters, aunts, uncles, distant family members, and people that lived down the street, were then loaded into railroad cars with the destination unknown. And after traveling several days, those that were in these railroad cars were then herded like animals through these various checkpoints. And at the last checkpoint, with his mother on one side and his father on the other side, and just before they were separated, his mother leans over and says something to her young son that he has never forgotten. When they measure you, she said, be sure to stand on tiptoes. The next thing he knew, Samuelson was, his mother was gone, his father was gone. For you see, those that measured up were spared. As for the others, they were never heard from again. Samuelson closes his story by telling his students that he will never forget the look on his mother's face the last time he saw her. And it's from that look, he says, that look of love, that he lives his life. And as often as he remembers that look, he tells his students that he's empowered to live each day of his life on tiptoes. I first met Carl, or as I used to call him, CEZIII, not long into my first year in seminary. That was 1981. On Saturday mornings, I'd go across the street from where we were living in Fort Worth and go across the campus at TCU into the Rickle building. There was the gymnasium I would go to work out. And invariably, at some point in the morning, the late morning, there would be this smell that would suddenly permeate the building. And after a while, I said, "What in the heck is that smell?" That's the building manager, Carl Zerweck. He's cooking sausage and peppers. Talk about a smell. From that day on, I would always try to do my exercising before Carl got there. For the next 4 years or so, I got to know Carl through the classes we had together and going out to play shuffleboard at a local bar not far from campus and playing intramurals with him. And I have to tell you, he was a fierce competitor on the athletic field. We were older graduate students playing younger undergraduate students, and as one might expect, he did not take any crap off those younger guys. He played with passion the minute he stepped on the field. Maybe that's why he was both the captain of the intramural football team and also the captain of the softball team. And there were times, and I got to tell you this, that I had to hold him back. All he wanted to do was to open a can of you-know-what on those undergraduates. What I remember most from seminary days is that Carl would take as many of these social ministry classes as he could. And while he never said it to me, I guess that, again, he felt that was his calling. Some are preachers. Some are called as pastors. Some are called as theologians. Carl's work, his calling, was to get people off their knees and onto their feet. And the way to do that was to work with his hands and side by side with others. On graduation, naturally, we both went our own way. He was called to the staff at a church in the Dallas Metroplex area, and I went to Louisiana. However, we stayed in touch during those next several years, phone calls, ministers' meetings, conferences, and even assemblies. And in the summer of 2003, I had the opportunity to see Carl's love of hands-on ministry firsthand. I decided to join him in a church build in Yakima, Washington. Now, I remember that build for several reasons, not only because it was my first build with him, but because of something that happened after the first day or two that we were there. Not long after arriving, Carl tells me that there's no running water in the place where we're going to stay. And I ask him, "How are you going to clean up and shower after we work all day?" "We'll figure something out," he said. Still, I remember riding him all that day and most of the night and even into the next day. How are we going to stay clean after 5 or 6 or 7 days? But bright and early that second morning, I got up to someone hammering on the side of the house where we were staying. When I finally made it outside, Carl had constructed this makeshift shower out of 2x4s in black tarp. And more, he had run a garden hose, get this, my friends, from the neighbor's house and to the side of our house where we were staying. Crude, it was cold water, but it worked. A few years later, I was pastoring a church in eastern North Carolina when I heard that there was this new church a new church built about an hour south of me in Kinston, North Carolina. Predominantly black church. Then purchased some land outside of town, and there was a region-wide call for volunteers to help build this church. As before, the effort was part of the denomination's Division of Homeland Ministries and this group called Volunteers in Mission. And guess who was leading that effort? C-E-Z-I-I-I. And after that, I hooked up with Carl and I assisted in building that church. In 2008, Carl married my wife and I. He officiated. And before long, my wife and I joined Robin and he in yet another build in Beaumont, Texas. Needless to say, my friends, all along I was seeing Carl's devotion to this, his particular calling, an aspect of ministry more. I think I came to understand more and more what Carl received from doing hands-on ministry. It was gratifying, yes, but it was working with others on a common goal. In this case, constructing a church. I guess it was after that Beaumont build that our friendship became even closer. I know for a fact that his love for hands-on ministry took a giant step forward when he was asked to again establish a permanent ministry here in Detroit. And so for the next decade or so, he took a certain degree of pride in ministering to those that he called his friends. He loved what he was doing. He loved the neighborhoods where he was working. He loved the people that were in there. But what he seemed to be most proud of was introducing that love of ministry, of hands-on ministry, to college kids and church groups from around the country. It was the sheer joy I saw in him of doing hands-on ministry. And like so many other places that he had been, during a student at Bright, the nationwide church builds, Carl became the group's face. This burly, bearded, boisterous guy became the identity and the face of Rippling Hope. Carl's efforts and his energy gave the group its being and its physical presence. People may not have known Carl by name, but they knew his commitment to making the lives of people better. He was not Carl Zerweck. He was not C-E-Z-I-I-I. He was, you know, that big guy with the beard and the glasses. During the past 2 years or so, the phone conversations between Carl and myself, they suddenly became more commonplace. Granted, the conversations wouldn't be weekly, but I can tell you they were at least monthly. And when we talked, we would touch on everything from church business to baseball and his love of those Cardinals, from religion to relationships, from politics to ministerial practices. It was not uncommon for one or the other of us to say that we had to go. We had to go because the batteries on our phones were running down. Last time I spoke with Carl was Friday night, December the 9th. We spoke for about 30 minutes, and before that it was December 7th for nearly 45 minutes. I called to talk to him about TCU playing in the Fiesta Bowl against University of Michigan. And I told him that I was going, and why don't he join me there? And he said he'd think about it, but he didn't want to be away from the pulpit that Sunday morning. Such was the depth of his love for this congregation and the people in it. After that December 9th call, I never talked to him again. And now I know why. even as a minister, that I'm a little angry at his passing. I'm angry because I've lost a friend of 40 years. A friend that we shared both our joys and our sorrows, from our professional life to our private one. I'm angry that countless individuals, young and not so young, may never get the chance to know this man who not only rehabbed houses, but repaired damaged souls.
Amen.
I'm angry that Carl will not get the physical opportunity to see his beloved frogs womp up on those Wolverines. Do I hear an amen on that? I don't think so. And I'm angry that he'll never get the chance to see the frogs win the national championship. But despite all the anger being felt with his passing, and despite all the pain and that we'll feel in his absence, Carl has left a legacy that will live on in our lives. What he did with his life, with his hands, taught all of us the value of sacrifice and the joy that comes from helping people even with their most basic of human needs. And through it all, as said and repeated time and time again, he did his work with dignity and respect and humility. He gave much, but he asked for very little. I told someone the other day that I would bet that since first getting involved in missionary work, I would almost bet that Carl has gone through more work boots than a Himalayan Sherpa, more work gloves than Walmart has stores, and has worn out the knees on more work pants than he has written sermons. But that was Carl, and his desire to make a difference in the lives of people. His ministry, his calling, was not to stand behind a pulpit or make hospital calls. His life was directed at physically helping those who found it difficult maybe to help themselves. And his love for making the lives of others easier, that was shown through his hands. And I'm convinced, I'm fully convinced that God has a special place for people like Carl. People who fly under the radar, their life work is done without fanfare and any acclaim. And as we gather here today, my friends, in the afterglow of his life, we should be thankful that we got to know a person of his character and his devotion. Individuals of his caliber, along with his respect for human life, they do not come along every day. And so we should, celebrate Carl's life as one that was unique. Yes, he was the preparer of the breach and restorer of streets, and he made an indelible mark on the lives of so many people. Otherwise, we wouldn't be here today. But let's not forget who made and put all this in motion. Almighty God. For it's God who first placed that calling on Carl's heart so many years ago. It was that God's hand that then instilled Carl a deep faith and that equipped him with a courageous soul to stand up to life's challenges on tiptoes. It was God who then sent Carl into the world to make a difference in people's lives. It was God who finally set everything in motion. God willed, and God directed all this. above all, we should be thankful that God, in his divine love for us, allowed Carl's life and our life to intersect. I know I am.
On a hill far away stood an old rugged cross, the emblem of suffering and shame. But I loved that old cross, where the dearest and best for a world of lost sinners was slain. We come now to celebrate the one who gives us hope, to celebrate what was done on the cross and that glorious resurrection that has established for us hope that we will meet Carl. On the night he was betrayed, Jesus took bread. He broke it, and he gave it to his disciples, saying, "This is my body, broken for you. Take, eat, do this in remembrance of me." In the same manner, he took the cup, saying, "This cup is the new covenant in my blood, which is poured out for you. Drink in remembrance of me." As you receive the elements, would you also join me in prayer? Gracious and loving God, we thank you for the saving acts of Jesus on the cross of Calvary. We thank you, O God, for the glorious hope that we have in his resurrection. Now, O God, we pray your blessings upon these emblems. Pray your blessing upon us as we partake in remembrance of him. In Jesus' name. Proclaim the Lord's death until he comes. couple of housekeeping notes that I've been asked to give you, that at the close of service, we'll ask you to just kind of step aside, because they're going to need to remove some of the chairs from the sanctuary into the place where the meal will take place. So if you will just give them some space and also some time to get that done, and they would be so very grateful. Again, thank you for being here to celebrate. To celebrate the life of my friend and your friend, a unique man of God, Carl Edward Zerweck, 123. Let us pray. Gracious and loving God, we thank you for the life of Carl Zerweck. Thank you, Lord, for all the many memories he gave us, all the many hands and hearts he touched, all the many people he helped, and the legacy that he has left for us in rippling hope. We ask you, O God, to guide us and direct us as we continue that legacy. And ask you, O God, to be with us as we leave this place, this celebration. Thank you, God, for Carl. Thank you, God, for his ministry. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen. Now, may the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, the sweet communion of the Holy Spirit, rest, rule, and abide both.